Welcome to lecture 13 on module 5 for the subject ARM microcontroller and embedded systems. So the subject code is 17EC or 15EC62. So in the previous lecture we discussed about task synchronization using sleep and wake method. Okay, sleep and wake method, and that is implemented using semaphores. So we discussed about semaphores, binary semaphore and counting semaphore. So I told that they are just like a key to a room to access a resource. So next we shall discuss about how to choose an RTOS, real-time operating system. So there are certain criteria or requirements that you need to think of before choosing an RTOS. So what are those requirements? Those requirements can be split up into two parts or two types of requirements. First one is functional requirements, so next one is non-functional requirements. So first we shall discuss about functional requirements. So whenever you want to choose a RTOS, what are the functional requirements you need to consider? So the first thing is processor support. Okay, so which all processors that particular operating system supports, that particular RTOS supports, because many might have already know this, that not all the operating systems support all the processors. So there are certain processors an operating system will support. So which are those processors you should first know, because which is the processor you are using in your design, and whether the RTOS that you have chosen will support this processor that you have chosen in your design. So that you should verify. So that is what the processor support means. So it is not necessary that all the RTOS support all kind of processors. It is essential to ensure the processor supported by RTOS. So whether the processor you have used in your design is supported by the RTOS that you have chosen, that should be very much verified before you opt for a RTOS. So next is memory requirement. So once you choose an RTOS, how much memory it requires? Okay, so that memory can be both in terms of primary memory as well as secondary memory. So that should be very important. So example will give, suppose you want to design or you want to come up with a new mobile phone, and you choose an operating system for that mobile phone. So let's say your mobile phone is having a internal memory of 16 GB, which is the secondary memory. So out of the 16 GB, the RTOS that you have chosen will consume, let's say, 12 GB. Okay, so out of 16 GB, the RTOS that you are trying to install in that mobile phone that you have chosen, the RTOS, it itself will consume 12 GB. So that means, what is the available memory? So it is just 4 GB. Out of 16 GB, only 12 GB is used by the OS, and only remaining is 4 GB. So which is not feasible solution. Okay, so you should choose an RTOS which will consume less space. So out of 16 GB, let's say it will consume 2 or 3 GB, so that remaining 11 GB is still available for the user. So that is what is desirable. So this is about the secondary memory requirement, as well as you should also be aware of how much primary memory that OS requires to run. Okay, so example, so the mobile phone that you are trying to let's say build has only 2 GB of RAM. Okay, so let's say it has 2 GB of RAM, and this OS that you have, RTOS that you have chosen, it will consume about 1.5 GB of RAM. So out of 2 GB of RAM, the OS to run itself will consume 1.5 GB of RAM. So only 0.5 GB of RAM is left, which is not sufficient for other processes that will run, for other applications that will run. So it is not a feasible solution. So the ROM and RAM requirement should be analyzed before you choose a RTOS based on your requirement. And the lesser the memory it consumes, the RTOS, the more it is desired. Okay, so that is what is generally the consideration. So next is real-time capabilities. So whether the RTOS that you choose is real-time, or the application that you have designed, the application that you are trying to design, whether it requires an RTOS. So some applications may not require an RTOS. Okay? See, it is not mandatory that OS for all embedded systems be real time. So some OSs for an embedded system may not be real time. So, and that application may not demand a real time OS. Okay, and all embedded operating systems are real time behavior. Okay, so some embedded systems may not be real time, but they are still embedded systems. Okay, so yeah, that is what is real time capabilities. Next is kernel and interrupt latency. So what do you mean by this? See, the kernel of the OS that you have decided that you will use in your application may disable interrupts while executing certain services. So what will happen if you disable interrupts? So if you disable interrupts while executing certain services, so if an interrupt comes, so that interrupt will not be serviced in immediately because that interrupt is disabled. Okay, so hence the time it takes to respond to that interrupt will be more, because it will not be serviced immediately. It will take some time so that interrupt is given the chance to execute itself, that is the ISR for that. So it will increase the service time. So if it increases the service time, the latency will also increase. So depending on the application, you have to choose the RTOS with less interrupt latency as desired. So next is inter-process communication is task synchronization. So this is again very important, as we saw what is the use of IPC and what is the use of task synchronization in the previous lectures. Okay. Next is modularization support. What do you mean by modularization? See, this is a simple example. Let's say I'll give. So let's say this is the OS which will provide all the services. So let's say it will provide the services handling audio, it will have the services for handling video, it will have the services for handling image, okay, and it will have the services to handle the task synchronization, it will have the services for handling the task communication. So let's say these are all the services provided by OS. So modularization support means, so out of these services, let's say for your application, you don't require video services. Okay, you don't require video services. So since you don't require video services for your application, the modularization concept will allow to only remove this service from your OS. That is video service from your OS, you can remove this off. Okay, so once you remove this off, you can recompile this OS kernel so that the OS will have only audio services, image services, then task synchronization and task, communication. So video service is left out. So since you are leaving out the video service, so let's say this video service consumes 100 MB of space to operate. So since you are left out this, you are saving 100 MB of memory. Getting this concept? So that is what you mean by modularization. See, the OS provides a bunch of features, so at times it may not be necessary for an embedded product for functioning. So you can remove that service if you don't want and recompile the OS image without that service. So one of the examples is Windows CE, which provides highly modular operating system in which you can remove the services if you don't want. Next is support for networking and communication. So support for networking and communication. This is again very important because your embedded product may require to communicate with some other device or some other. So let's say it want to connect to an internet so that you can control that product using an internet connection. So in that case, networking and communication support is important. Okay. So you should make sure that the OS that you have decided to use supports networking and communication and driver supports. Next is important is development language support. So which development language does your OS support? Okay, so there are various development language that is supported by OSS. So you should choose in a way that language is more easy and it is more popular, so that you can do the maintenance work. So these are the functional requirements of choosing an RTOS. Next, coming to the non-functional requirements. So the first non-functional requirement you have to see is custom developed or off the shelf. That is, custom developed means whether the OS that you are trying to use in your embedded product is developed by you itself. Okay, whether you are developing that OS, that is what you mean by custom developed. Or off the shelf means whether you are using an already available OS. Okay, that is what you mean by custom developed or off the shelf. See, example, Windows 10 or all the Windows OS, they are off the shelf OSs. Why? Because they are not developed by the user. They are developed by a company and that OS is already available. If you want it, you can purchase it and install it. So these are off the shelf OSs. They are already available. Just make use of the available OS. But custom developed means, so you are developing your own OS. So let's say you, for your embedded product, you decide that you should not use any other OS from some other vendor because you are not sure about how secure is that OS. So then in that case, you yourself develop an OS, a custom OS, so that you are sure that your OS is, let's say, very secure. So military applications, in military applications, they will not install Windows OS or Linux OS. No, they will develop their own OS because they should be very sure that the OS is very secure. It cannot be hacked. Okay. So next is cost. So second non-functional requirement is cost. So let's say you come up with an idea of using an OS. What is the cost of that OS? Okay, so the cost should be as minimum as possible because it indirectly let's say feeds the total cost of your embedded product. So let's say you want to bring up an embedded product within 10,000. So let's say the OS that you have chosen should not cost you more than, let's say, 1,000 per device. Getting this? So out of 10,000, the OS will only contribute 10% of the cost, or even less. So that is what is the cost. Okay. Next is development and debugging tools. So this is again very important. Once you decide a OS, so there should be debugging tools available in case the OS malfunctions. In case there are some bugs in the OS, or say the OS misbehaves or the OS crashes, you should be able to debug it using the available tools. So the tool support is very much needed. Okay. So if there are more tools or more set of tools available to debug an OS, then that OS will become more popular. Okay. So if there are no tools itself to debug an OS, so no one will choose the OS. So next is the last one, ease of use. So how easy it is to use the OS that you have chosen. So example is the iOS and the Android OS. So many people prefer the Android OS because the interface is very simple. Okay, and anyone can operate that OS, Android OS. But iOS is not so user friendly. Okay, so it requires some get used to. Okay, so that you can be familiar with the options and you'll know how to use it. Right. So that is what the requirements of OSs. So this is how you choose a RTOS. So next we'll talk about integration of hardware and firmware. So what do you mean by integration of hardware and firmware? See, it is very simple. See, always the hardware and this firmware or the software for embedded product, they are developed parallelly. They are not developed serially. That is, once the hardware development is done, then they will go for the software development. No, that will not happen in any case. So they will happen parallelly. How they will happen parallelly? See, one team will be given the responsibility for developing the hardware, and the other team will be given the responsibility for developing the software. and both the teams will be working simultaneously so that the overall time required to develop the hardware and firmware will be minimum. So what happens if they go in sequential ways? So first hardware development should be done. Once it is finished, then software development will start from there and it will take some time to finish. So it will consume more time. Okay, so example, let's say hardware development takes 10 days to complete and software development takes 8 days to complete. Then if it is sequential manner, that is once hardware development is done, then software development should be done. So totally it will take 10 plus 8 days to complete your product, totally 18 days. Okay, if it is sequential product development or hardware and software development. So what if it is parallel development? Parallel development means hardware and software are developed parallelly, simultaneously. Then what will happen is the entire development will not be 10 plus 8, it will be maximum among these two, so which is 10. So because the software has development completed in 8 days and hardware will complete in 10 days, so the maximum time you require to complete your entire product is 10 days, that's all. So this is what is the advantage of hardware software co-design. So it is known as co-design or parallel development. So once you develop them separately, the last thing you have to do is you have to integrate both. So what do you mean by integrate both? See, the hardware is separate and the software is separate. You have to load the software to the hardware. So loading the software or the firmware to the hardware is known as integration. So there are various ways to do this integration of firmware to hardware. So we shall see what are those. See, the process of embedding intelligence to the product is known as integration. So intelligence means software. So you are loading the intelligence or software or firmware to the hardware. That is what you mean by integration. So integration of hardware and firmware deals with embedding firmware into the target board. So putting the software or hardware or loading the software or hardware to the loading the software to the hardware. Right? That is what you mean by integration. So there are products in which there may be no operating systems. Okay. So in such cases, so if there is no OS, so why when do you don't choose a OS? If the application is very simple, then you don't need a OS. So example is the toy car application. So the toy car may not need a OS, or it will not need an OS because there are no multiple tasks, or that particular application doesn't demand a multitasking environment. So in that case, OS is not needed. And in a toy car application, the memory is also less. Whatever the processor or the internal memory the processor contains is also less. So the toy car, you cannot expect the toy car to have 64 GB of memory. No. So the memory will be in terms of KB. So since the memory itself is in terms of KB, whatever the software that you write or the firmware that you write, it will also be in terms of KB that will fit into this processor memory. So this is for applications which don't require an operating system. So if the processor doesn't support an internal memory, so you have to interface an external memory to the processor so that that memory can be used to store the firmware or the OS. So usually the memory will be a EEPROM or a flash memory that you use, in which you dump the code. Okay, you dump the OS or you dump the code, and you interface that memory with the processor because the processor itself doesn't have any memory. Okay, so now we shall come to the techniques used for integration of firmware to the hardware. So a variety of techniques used for embedding firmware into target board. So the commonly used firmware embedded techniques for non-OS based embedded systems. So first we shall discuss about the techniques which are used for integrating or embedding the firmware onto the hardware for non-OS based embedded products. Okay, so there are no OSs involved here, but you will write some code. You have to dump that code to the target board. So there are various techniques for that. So these are for non-OS based systems. The first technique is out of the system or out of the circuit programming. Okay, so what will be done here is, this is performed outside the target board. Okay, see example, what do you mean by target board is, see if you remember the lab, the ARM lab, ARM microcontroller lab, so there is a board, the target, so that is what you mean by the target board, wherein the processor or the controller sits and all the required peripheral sit. So that is the target board. So now, in order to load the firmware or software or the code to that board, what you have to do is, so you have to remove the memory from that board and you have to place that memory somewhere in a programmer so that that memory can be programmed with the code. Once the memory is ready with the code, you can remove that memory from the programmer and reinstall that to the target board. So that is what will happen in out of circuit programming. So it is performed outside the target board. So you cannot directly code or dump the code to the target board. That is not allowed. The processor or memory chip into which the firmware needs to be embedded is taken out. As I told, you have to remove the memory chip out of that target board and you have to place that memory chip in a programming device. So this is the programming device, you can see. So this is the zip socket. Okay, so this is similar to your LD or digital electronics trainer kits, wherein there is a zip socket wherein you place the IC and lock the IC so that it will not move around. Okay, hope you got this. So this is the intelligent universal programmer. So whichever memory you want to program, so you have to remove that memory from the target board and place the memory here onto this, okay, and then program it and then again remove it and again place it to the target. So this is what will happen in out of circuit programming. So the programming device is a dedicated unit. So this is the programming device, dedicated unit which contains necessary hardware circuit for generating the program signals. The programmer, so that is, this is the programmer, contains a ZIF socket. So this is the ZIF socket here with locking pin to hold the device to be programmed. Okay, so next, the programming device will be under the control of utility program running on a PC. What do you mean by that? So this is the programmer here. Okay, so this programmer will be connected to a PC. Okay, so this PC, it will have an interface, it will have the code. So from this PC, the code will be communicated to this programmer and this programmer will in turn program the IC connected to this ZIF socket. This is what will happen, okay, in out of the circuit programming. Simple. So there is some sequence here. So how to program a device? So this sequence can be asked. So what is the sequence of programming in out of circuit programming? So you have to write this sequence along with this diagram. So connect the programming device to the specified PC. Okay, so specified port of the PC. That is, connect this programming device to this port. So this port can be a USB port, it can be RS-232 port also. Okay. So next, power up the device. Okay, that is, you have to power up this device as well as the PC. Then execute the programming utility on the PC and ensure proper connectivity is established. Okay, so you should ensure that there is proper established communication between these two happening before you program them. Okay, or before you start to program. Then unlock the ZIF socket, then insert the device to be programmed into the socket and lock it. Okay, that means insert the IC here. Insert the IC here and lock the ZIF socket. So once it is locked, then select the device name. So let's say you are programming a microcontroller, some 8051 device. So you have to select that device name. Where you will select the device name? In the PC. Okay, so hope you remember that you select the device first in your key IDE. Okay, which device you are trying to program. like that. You have to select it, then give the program option. So it will wait for some time until the program is completed. So a busy LED is programmer is off. So that means the program is completed programming, and you can unlock the device from this zip socket. So once you unlock the device, you can place the device back to the target board. So remember, the target board is the board which looks like the ARM microcontroller board in your lab. So that is the target board. This is out of circuit programming. So next is in circuit programming or in system programming, ISP, in system programming. So as the name itself indicates, it is within the system. So here you need not take out the processor or the memory out of the target board and place it in a programmer like this to program it or to dump the code. Okay, so if you remember, in the ARM lab, what we do is we just connect the target board to the PC through a USB cable. We power up the board and we use the flash programming. Okay, so if you remember, we use the flash programming tool here. Okay, so this one flash programming tool here to program your board. So once this flash programming opens, so you select the device and the COM port and baud rate. Okay, so everything is done, and you select the code, the whatever the hex file that you have generated using this browse button, and then just give start. That's all. So once you give start, immediately the programming will start. So you need not take the processor out of the board to program it. So you just connect the board to the USB port of the PC and you program it. That's all. So that is what is in system programming. So you require a PC, you require a cable, and you require a utility. So utility is nothing but the flash magic utility that I just showed. Okay, so the programming can be done through a serial port, parallel port, or a USB port. That is sufficient. Or the programming can also be done using a JTAG or a SPI controlled protocol. So the SPI, you already studied this in module 3, serial peripheral interface, how it will work. So it will have, so whenever it is you want to program the device, it should be in ISP mode, that is in system programming mode. Once it is in system programming mode, you can program the processor or the memory. So this ISP can be implemented using SPI protocol. So you already know the SPI protocol. So it will utilize these signals. So MOSI, master out, slave in, MISO, master in, slave out. This is a system clock, and this is reset and ground. So these are the control signals that are used for communication through SPI protocol. So again, there is a sequence of operations you have to follow in order to program the device. So just go through this sequence of programming, so which you already used many times in your lab. So same sequence will be here, okay, with minor modifications. That's all. So again, you can see clock frequency is selected, okay, then the device is selected, all those things, right? Next, the third type of embedding firmware to a non-OS based embedded product is in-application programming. So in-application programming is a technique used by firmware running on the target device for modifying a selected portion of the code memory. So see the definition here. It's a technique used by firmware running on a target device. So already a firmware is running on the target device. So for that same target device, you are modifying a selected portion of the code memory. Okay, so for your embedded product, already you have programmed it once. Okay, so the second time you want to program, you want to change something in that program that you already programmed to an embedded product. So you can do that. So in that case, the firmware itself can program it. So it is just like installing an update on your mobile phone. Okay, so your mobile phone is already running an OS. So some OTA or on the air update will come to your mobile phone. So what that OS that is already running in your app, in your mobile phone does, it will download that update and the OS itself will install that update onto your mobile phone. So this is that particular type of programming is known as in-application programming. And this cannot be used for first time embedded firmware programming. So this cannot be used for first time programming. That is, if there is no firmware in your embedded product, you cannot use in-application programming for the first time, because in-application programming can be used only when there is already an firmware or a OS currently running in your embedded product. So making use of that OS, you are installing an update or you are modifying some code. So that is what. So this is not the technique for first time installation. This is the technique for updating the OS or installation. Okay. So that is what. So again, ISP. So just go through this simple explanation. So hope you got the concept. So next, the last type of integration for non-OS based applications are factory program chip. So the name itself indicates factory program chip. So what it will do is, so embed the firmware into a target processor or controller at the time of chip manufacturation itself. So at the time of chip fabrication itself. So whenever that processor or memory comes out of the let's say factory, then itself the program will be done. Okay, so the end user cannot do the programming, it will be done in the factory itself. Okay, as long as the firmware design is over and firmware achieved stability, the firmware files can be sent to the chip fabricator to embed it into the code memory. So it is one time programming. Okay, so wherein it is factory program, the end user cannot program it. Okay, so this is mainly used or in mass production applications. It is not recommended to use this factory programmed for firmware which undergoes frequent changes. So if there are regular updates released for that OS, so or the firmware, so you should not go for factory programmed, because once it is programmed, you cannot reprogram it. Okay, it is just like one time programmable memory. So these are the techniques for non-OS based integration of firmware to the hardware. So next technique is, so it is for the firmware based integration of OS to the firmware or OS to the OS based hardware. So OS based product. So in this case, what will happen is, so the OS based embedded systems are programmed using in-system programming techniques. So the OS based embedded systems contain a special piece of code called bootloader. So bootloader means it is a basic OS, or you can also call it as BIOS, basic input output OS. Okay. So there will be a BIOS for every PC, every laptop. What is the use of this BIOS is, this is the primitive OS which will be present, which is responsible for loading the main OS. Okay, so the main OS, as soon as you turn on your PC or laptop, the main OS will not start itself. Okay, so the first thing that will start is this bootloader or the BIOS. So once the BIOS starts, so it will start to pull the main OS to the main memory or the RAM, so that the OS starts to load itself. So you can say this bootloader or BIOS is the primitive OS which will start the main OS. Okay, so that is what is discussed here. So this bootloader, so and the OS loading can be done over the network also. Okay, so there are network based OS, so wherein the OS is not installed in the PC. Okay, it is installed in a server. So this PC, it will be connected to the server through a wired network like a LAN or a WAN. So once you boot up the start the PC, the OS will be loaded onto the PC from the server. So you need not install the OS to your laptop. The OS is fetched from the server, which is present somewhere in the campus, and this is done using a network. or a LAN or a WAN. Okay, so this is about integrating the software or the firmware to the hardware. So next is embedded system development environment. So this is a diagram for this. This is the environment for a embedded system development. So what are the environments? So what are the environment is nothing but what are the various components that are used to build an embedded product. So from this you can see, first thing you require is a PC or a laptop which will have all the software that is needed for embedded product. Okay, so as soon as you come to software, it means it should require the EDA tool, it should have the IDE tool. So what do you mean by IDE tool? It is integrated development environment. So the example for IDE tool is the Keel tool that you have already used, right? So this tool, you use it for programming, you use it for program error checking, you use it for compiling, you use it for hex file generation. Okay, so all this, so entire thing is there in this IDE. Okay, so that is the example for IDE, integrated development environment. So next tool you require is EDA, so I'll come to that later. So first you require IDE. Okay, so then using this IDE, okay, you use a emulator, okay, for checking your code. What do you mean by emulator? So a very simple example for emulator is your FPGA or CPLD kit that you have used in your HDL lab. So what you do is you use IDE to write the code, and then you dump that code to the FPGA board through this PC. Okay, so once you dump the code to the FPGA or the emulator, okay, then you verify whether the code is working. So example, you have dumped a full adder code to your FPGA board in your HDL lab. What do you do? Next, you verify that. How you verify? Using single strand wires or the Burk sticks, you connect the ports, the IO pins to the inputs and check the output, whether the full adder is working as per the truth table or not. Okay, you do that, right? So that is what you do using a emulator. So emulator means it is not the target board. It will act as a target board, that's all. Okay, it will mimic the target board, but it is not the actual target board. That is what you mean by emulator. So a simple example for emulator is a CPLD or a FPGA. Why? Because if you want to implement a full adder, the CPLD will act as a full adder. If you want to implement a parallel adder, the CPLD will act as a parallel adder. If you want to implement a multiplexer, the CPLD will act as a multiplexer. So since whatever you want, the CPLD is acting like it, so that is what it is. You say as mimicking. So it will mimic a full adder. It will mimic a multiplexer. So that is why it is known as an emulator, but not the target board. Okay, so hope you are getting this. So this is what you mean by emulator. So once you write the code in the IDE and dump it to the emulator and verify, so then you are sure that your code will work. Getting this, then you go for the target board. So once you are sure that your code is working in the emulator, you will dump the same code to the target board. So that is the board that you use in your ARM microcontroller. Okay, so once you write the code in Keel, you dump that code to the target board. You will not go to an emulator. You will go to an emulator in your HDL lab, but you don't go to the emulator in your ARM lab, because the target board is directly available. Just make use of it. So directly dump the code to the target board. So once you dump the code to the target board, you can provide the inputs to the target board and check whether the code is working fine. So how will you check the code? So using a logic analyzer or a CRO, using a multimeter by taking the readings, okay, or using a signal source to give the input, like that. Okay, so give the input, check the output. So the output can be checked using multimeters for voltages or currents. You can check the waveforms using a CRO, okay, or you can indicate the outputs using LEDs. That is also fine, LEDs. So once this is done, suppose you want to create your own hardware, then you require this EDA tool. electronic design automation tool. If the target board is not there, so you go for an emulator and you are sure that your code is working with your emulator, then since there is no target board, you have to create your own target board. So how will you create your own target board? Using an EDA tool. So this EDA tool will give you an interface to create your own target board, your new target board. So making use of that, you create a new target board by generating the PCB and whatever the components required, the layout, the schematic, okay, so everything, the layout versus schematic, fine, everything you can do in EDA tool to get your own target board if there is no target board. So this is a simple explanation for the embedded system development environment. So whatever I told now, so they have discussed that in this explanation. Okay, so just go through. So in the explanation, they have discussed about each components, about the PC, about the IDE, about the EDA tool, okay, about the target board, about the analyzer, about the emulator, about these interfaces. Everything is discussed here. So just a para for each of the component in that diagram. Okay. So just go through it. So this will complete. This will complete the module 3. Sorry, module 5. This will complete the module 5. This is the last lecture on module 5. Okay, so hope you got the concept. So for any doubts, queries, you can contact me.